So, chapter 11, interactions between microbes and humans. It seems like we're skipping ahead, but in the reality, we're going to talk about how we affect microorganisms and how microorganisms affect us, and sort of if there is a balance between the two. So, the human body is in what we consider a state of dynamic equilibrium with microorganisms. What we mean by that is that there is a balance, okay? A balance between the symbiotes, or good organisms, the ones that we actually appreciate, okay? The ones that are helpful to us. Okay? Lots of times we also call these mutualists, okay? And pathobiotes, or pathogens, with the commensals having no effect. Okay? What we see is this sort of immunological equilibrium where we live with our organisms. Okay? That they do not necessarily disrupt us. We sort of tread this fine line, this nice balance, okay, between us and the pathogens and the mutualists and the symbiotes. Okay? So when infectious disease happens, what we see is disruption of the balance. Okay? Instead, when individuals are sick, we see the balance tip in favor of the pathogens. You can see that here. Okay. The end result of this is that there's some type of tissue damage or disruption to the overall organism, and this is what we consider disease. Okay. Now, the general progression of disease is that contact eventually leads to infection. So, contact progressing to infection. Okay. So contact, actually just getting the organisms on you, this can be surface organisms. Infection, where the organisms begin to multiply, okay? And then eventual progression to disease, where there is some type of damage involved. Okay? Now, the goal in any type of healthcare setting, or pretty much for all of us in our everyday lives, is what we consider contamination without colonization and colonization without disease. In other words, actually having the organisms on you, but not having them grow or multiply. That would be contamination without colonization. Or letting them grow and multiply, but keeping them in check so that they do not do damage. So that would be colonization without disease. Those are the goals of any type of contact with a microorganism. So we're going to talk a little bit now about what we consider resident biota. Okay? I will also call this your normal microflora. Okay? Indigenous flora is another term for it. This can include types of bacteria, fungi, protozoans, viruses, arthropods. Okay? It just depends upon where you live and what is normal for certain individuals in certain situations or areas. Okay? One useful part of this, and something that's been going on for a while, it started about 10 years ago, is something that we call the Human Microbiome Project. And scientists involved with the Human Microbiome Project are actually using something called metagenomics to study all of the genomes within an individual niche. Okay. Now, metagenomics within the Human Microbiome Project actually involve all of the genes within human cells, which is about 22,000 protein encoding genes, okay, and then all of the genes involved in our microbiota. Okay. In other words, the genes that the bacteria that live in or on us have. And they end up with about 8 million protein encoding genes, which is really, really neat. So they're way outdoing us when it comes to the normal number of proteins. Right? Now, why do this is sort of the next question. Well, part of the reason for this is because we want to know how those proteins that these organisms are making and basically what genes they have, how these proteins and how these enzymes are affecting us. Okay? because we know that individuals that are deficient in certain types of microorganisms actually end up having health consequences because of that. Some interesting ones that you can see here. Okay. Propionic bacterium, acne, okay, the skin and nose of most people, it is a common cause of acne. Okay. Let's see. Provotella species over here, commonly present in the GI tract. Okay. 19% of subjects and dominates intestinal flora when present. So the Provotella species are actually very, very common part of your normal intestinal tract. Okay. Lactobacillus, okay. Very, very common in the vagina. Staphylococcus, external body sites. Okay. E. coli, present in the gut of the majority of healthy subjects, but at a very low abundance. So we see them there. And a lot of these actually do things for us. For example, we know that the E. coli in our intestinal tract is very good at helping us extract vitamin K from certain types of foods. Without the E. coli, we would probably have very little access to vitamin K. Okay. This is what's called a phylogenetic map. What you're seeing here are all of the different types of species. Every little one of these dots, circles, and squares, and stars at the end of one of these lines actually represents a different species of bacteria. So we're seeing a lot of different types of bacteria actually being relatively common within the human as a home. So let's talk about acquiring resident biota. Okay? How do we get normal microflora? Well, the human body itself has what we consider an endless variety of microbial niches. In other words, there are a lot of homes and jobs for these organisms to do. We have lots of different places for them to live, different styles of habitats. Okay? Now, the majority of microorganisms that actually enter into the body, okay, are destroyed by the immune system before they're able to begin colonizing. Okay? That's very, very common. The ones that actually end up staying have to find a way to develop a relationship with the host. Okay? That relationship has to involve that organism staying inside of the host but not being harmful to the host. Because if the organisms cause an abundant amount of damage or harm, then the host will eventually try to eject them. So our normal flora are attempting to sort of make peace, okay, with our body. So previously, okay, this is from the second edition of your textbook, this table, okay, 11.2. Anatomical sites and fluids thought to be sterile, okay? All internal tissues and organs. Okay? Now, things that we know are that those are slowly starting to go away, mainly because we've detected very low amounts of DNA, okay, from microorganisms within a lot of these areas. So even if the organisms aren't getting there, the DNA from those organisms are somehow, at least in very minute quantities, making it to these areas. So there's internal tissues and organs, heart, liver, kidneys, bladder, bones, ovaries, middle ear, basically anywhere internal to the body. Fluids, often thought to be sterile, meaning that they're not going to have normal microflora. Blood, urine that's in the kidneys. Or in the bladder, not urine on its way out. On its way out, it's going to come in contact with external environment. It's going to have plenty of normal microflora. Okay, so basically, a lot of internal structures. Okay, now we also see in the new text, this is in your current edition, okay, that we know certain areas have normal microflora. Okay, look at this. Skin, mucous membranes, upper respiratory tract. I always tell people that's from your trachea up. gastrointestinal tract, outer portion of the urethra, external genitalia, vagina, external ear, external eye. So basically, anything that is in contact with the outside is pretty much automatically going to have a normal flora to it. Okay. Places where we're now seeing some normal microflora, or at least DNA from normal flora, breast milk, amniotic fluid, the bladder, the lungs. This was a big surprise to us, especially the amniotic fluid, because we really, really, really thought that the uterus was quite sterile. Now what we're learning is that there seem to be some microorganisms in the amniotic fluid at certain time periods, and they're starting to stimulate production of immune system cells actually much earlier than we thought. So as our tests get better, we actually seem to be able to find more minute scales of organisms. So why is this here? Why do we have normal microflora? Well, one of the biggest reasons behind having a normal microflora is something we call microbial antagonism. I very commonly say this, that the organisms take up space, okay? And that is great for us. What we mean here is that normal microflora are very unlikely to be kicked out of their niche, okay, by incoming microbes. So they say they're unlikely to be displaced. Okay. So if pathogens make their way into the body, they're not going to actually kick out bacteria that are normally found within an area and are actually inhabiting that particular region. Okay. Now, this is good for us because within the body there are a limited number of attachment sites. In other words, you can only fit so many microorganisms in a certain area of the body. Okay. And because those normal flora have taken up a foothold there, okay, your pathogens are not going to basically have a place to live. There's nowhere to move into. I always tell people to think of your body like an apartment complex. And if you fill it up with good renters, okay, in other words, good bacteria, and they're renting out all of the room in your apartment complex, when a bad renter or a pathogen comes in, they're not going to kick out a good renter to get their apartment. They just have nowhere to go. Okay? We also see organisms and the normal microflora that are there create chemical or physiological environments, okay, that end up being hospital to other types of micro hostile, I'm sorry, to other types of microorganisms. Okay? What this means is that it's very common for your normal microflora to sort of help your body fight off, okay, the organisms that are trying to invade. Okay. Probably the most common version of this is something that we call sorry, hold on. Something that we call bacteriocins. Okay. And bacteriocins are chemicals that some bacteria will actually release to get rid of bacteria that are trying to invade. Okay. I always tell people bacteriocins end up working similar to mace, okay, that your normal microflora basically end up macing invading organisms to keep them away from their home, which is you. They're trying to protect you. Now, your normal microflora is beneficial. At worst, it's commensal, meaning that it's just there having no effect on you whatsoever. And this is true for people that have a good functioning immune system. We like our bacteria. The stuff that is there is oftentimes quite helpful. So we like our normal microflora. We'd prefer that it be there. Okay. So things we see that weaken host defenses and have a tendency to increase susceptibility to infection. So, weakening host defenses, if we remember, the correct term for this is to immunocompromise. Okay. Old age or extreme use, so or extreme youth, infancy, for example. The older we get, the less sharp our immune system skills are. Extreme youth So being very, very young, like a newborn, basically lack of exposure gives you a very, very unexperienced immune system. Okay. So it's much more difficult to fight organisms off, invading organisms. Genetic defects in immunity or acquired defects in immunity, like AIDS. Okay. So genetic diseases that alter immunity or things that diseases that specifically cause autoimmune issues. Okay. Surgery and organ transplants, both of these inhibit your immune system. Underlying disease, cancer, liver malfunction, diabetes. Again, the immune system takes a hit here. Chemotherapy or other immunosuppressive drugs that sometimes is the treatment that weakens your immune system. Physical and mental stress especially, lots of people that are under a lot of stress have a tendency to sleep less. Your immune system is supported and replenished while you sleep. So physical and mental stress very often lead to a decreased immune system. Okay. Pregnancy, in an attempt to protect the fetus, pregnant women actually automatically decrease their immune system functions in order to keep the body from attacking the infant. Okay. Very, very common. Okay. And other infections, if the immune system is busy, okay, working on other infections, it automatically predisposes you to more infectious disease. So let's talk about bacterial colonization of the newborn. Okay. So until 2013, we considered the uterus a sterile environment. Now we see evidence of intestinal colonization in utero. In other words, there are microorganisms there. They make their way into the GI tract and begin colonizing the large intestine, okay, of a fetus before it is ever even born. Okay. First comprehensive exposure, so all-out exposure, happens with the breaking of the fetal membrane. So when the water breaks, okay, premature rupturing of the membranes can actually expose an infant to infection and predispose that infant to certain types of infections. The most comprehensive exposure we see during birth. Okay? And that obviously depends upon how you are born. There are multiple ways to do this. Babies that are born vaginally come in contact with their mother's vaginal biota. Okay? And babies that are born by a cesarean section actually first comprehensively come in contact with adult skin biota. Usually, this is mom. Interestingly enough, within 8 to 12 hours after delivery, a vaginally delivered baby has been colonized pretty much completely, as far as the skin is concerned, by Streptococci, Staphylococci, and Lactobacilli. The Lactobacillus provides the baby with necessary enzymes to digest milk. That's wonderful. We need those. Okay. So, this is another benefit to our microorganism. This Lactobacillus actually helps us in infancy begin to digest our food sources. Later colonizers, these are usually the Streptococci, the Staphylococci, protecting the baby from skin disorders and other conditions because both the Streptococcus and the Staphylococcus are very, very common when it comes to skin bacteria, skin flora. Okay. Human milk, so for the breastfed babies that are out there, contains around 600 species of bacteria. And a lot of those are actually going to be wonderful helping to colonize the newborn. So this is initial colonization. Obviously, the older you get, the more things you come in contact with, including things like food sources. Thus begins the sort of overall exposure and the building of a sufficient and good, well-functioning, normal microflora for an individual. So I'm going to stop here and call this part one of chapter 11. I'm going to do it in several parts. Trying to break things down into smaller snippets for you guys.